Good evening, everybody. I'm Jacob Kane. I'm the city planner for the city of Mount Pleasant, and I want to thank you all very much for giving up a very beautiful Friday evening to come in here to talk about everyone's favorite topic, planning. At least it's my favorite topic. So we've got a lot to do tonight, so I'm not going to take up any more time than that, other than to just reiterate thank you so much for being here. I'm going to turn things over to Brian Wright. Brian is the principal with Town Planning and Urban Design Collaborative, the consulting firm that the city of Mount Pleasant hired to take us through this process to create a new character-based code for our community. And we're very happy to have him here. So Brian, floor is yours.
All right. So how many people, is this their first time to participate in any of the events? Yes. All right. Good. So those who were here before, thanks for telling your friends. That's awesome. You followed instructions. So what we're going to do is go through a presentation. I'm going to try to go pretty quickly because the most important part is the end. After I'm done with the presentation, we're going to do a question and answer session, and then we're going to get to these table exercises, and that's really fun. That's where you guys get to be planners for the night and roll up your sleeves and pull out the markers and the dots and really start to engage in the process. I have with me a great team. It's not just me. So Becky is at the door there. She's going to be around helping. There's Way in the back. Bill is somewhere around. And then also Sandrine, who is not here, but she's part of the team as well. And so we'll all be working with you guys to craft the new update to the zoning ordinance. And we're going to make sure that, and for those of you who were here at the last presentation, you'll see a couple of familiar slides, so bear with me. But for all those new hands, one thing that's important to know is when you're talking about revising your zoning ordinance, it's just like when you get on an airplane, right? When you get on an airplane, you need to know just a couple of things. One, what time to be at the airport, and two, where you're going, and maybe three, where your seat is on the plane. But nobody expects you to go open up the cockpit door and go fly the plane, right? You have to expect that the captain, the pilot, and the co-pilot kind of know what's going on, and they're going to keep you safe. So when you see a picture like this, you're not sure, are they banking and coming in for a landing, or are they out of control and you're about to end up in the water down there, right? So there may be times when you go through this process where you feel compelled to become a master of zoning. Don't feel like you have to. You can if you want to. Some people get really into this. A lot of times what happens is when you think about zoning, you just only respond to zoning when there's an issue that's bothering you. And whatever that issue is, say, a lot of communities, people are wanting to do chickens in their backyard. I don't know if you guys have come to the chicken question yet, but so they want to do chickens in the backyard. So first thing you do is you go and look in the zoning. What does it say about chickens? Can you have chickens here? I don't want chickens next to me, and all that. And so that's most people's exposure to zoning. It's sort of issue, you know, related. It's not often that you're updating your whole zoning ordinance and, you know, all of a sudden now we're, you know, opening the whole document and you're looking at everything all at one time. And so a lot of times people feel that they need to become expert in it. So you can if you want, but don't feel like you have to participate in this process. I promise we won't crash the plane as we go through this. So for those of you who are wondering what is this zoning thing I keep talking about, we'll go through a brief explanation of what zoning is. So before you get to zoning, you actually have to understand that there is a comprehensive master plan that gives guidance to what you need to do in the city, and that's an adopted document. It's a long-range policy document, establishes a vision for the future. It's much more high-level than zoning is. It's all about policy for growth and development and specific action items to help implement that vision that's in the document. In your master plan, it talks about things like an appropriate housing mix, infill development, improving walkability, public art, retaining historic character, improving bike and pedestrian opportunities, and mixed use downtown. And so those are some of the key highlights from the comprehensive plan, and that's a great document. You guys can go and look at that, because the way that it works is that sets the tone for then the zoning to follow, and the zoning needs to support that. So what is zoning? So zoning is a way that cities group land into different areas, typically based on use, and we'll learn more about that in a minute. And it basically has, you know, different rules about what you can do in each of these zones. And so you'll see a map And this is a zoning map and has all the different colors that represent the zones of what you can do and what you can't do. But it doesn't cause anything to be built. It just tells you what you can build, how you can build it in each of the different zones. Okay, so it's just a map, and it's really, you know, invisible lines and colors on the map until you go out there and start building something. Now, zoning can create a place like this, and most communities in America we go to, they say, yes, this is a lovely place. We like this. I would like to go eat at that cafe or shop on that street or whatever. But it can just as well create this. And most places we go to in America, people say, no, we wouldn't like that in our community. Thank you very much. And we work all over the country, and so we get to ask a lot of people questions about these kind of things. So this is what you can also get with zoning. Here's something that zoning can't do, and this is something we hear a lot about, and I know that this is, you know, these T-shirts aren't from here, but it's not going to stop parties on porches and in yards, right? That's not one of zoning's function necessarily. It can impact that, you know, positively or negatively, but for those who came here for the zoning to solve all your concerns about the things that we've heard about over and over and over regarding this, it's not going to be the silver bullet for that. I mentioned that zoning usually separates uses. That's what they focus on in conventional zoning codes. So there's the shopping pod, and you know what that looks like, and there's the parking lots around it, and there's the office pod, and people go to the office park and work in the office pod, and there's single-family housing pods, there are multifamily housing pods. There are also school pods, you know, so there's gigantic schools. But what's happening in those things is it's separating one use from the next and causing some issues that are sort of new to our country. Before World War II, we did things a different way. We didn't focus so much on uses as the way to zone things. We focused more on creating complete communities, places for people where you live, work, and play, and, you know, all of that stuff in the same community. So if you look at most communities in the country and you ask people, you know, what would you like to see here, we hear people say things like, we want to be walkable, compact, diverse, and mixed use, very much like the list that's in your comprehensive plan. So you guys have already had this discussion. That document's been adopted, and it just so happens that you guys are very similar to many other communities in the country wanting these things. Now, if you look at the cartoon here, on the bottom half of the image is a system that's set up with a conventional zoning where you're separating into these different pods like I was talking about. So here's a working pod, a shopping pod, a school pod, and a housing pod. And each of them is disconnected from the next. And to get anywhere for anything, you have to, every trip, get out on these collector roads and start causing traffic issues, right? So that's one of the things that happens. And it also takes a lot of time, and it starts to disconnect people socially, you know, from each other. And on the upper portion of the image is the way that people used to create communities, and that is with an interconnected network of streets. So there's a multitude of ways to get from here to there. So if you want to go shopping, you can do that, and you want to go to work, you can do that without ever having to get onto the collector road in many cases. But each of these different uses is intermingled within the community. They're not separated one from the next in the way that you see in conventional zoning today. So these are some of the things that, you know, we're talking about in nearly every community in the country, in everyone actually, not nearly everyone, in every community. So what we're talking about doing here is a character-based code that starts to work towards the upper half of the image and not so much towards the lower half of the image that I just showed. So in a character-based code, what we're doing is protecting the most loved parts of the city. So there's a protection component. We're also enhancing areas that need improvement, and we'll talk more about that with you guys in a minute. We are creating more predictable outcomes because one of the things we've heard here in most cities in the country is that we don't know what's going to happen when somebody starts wanting to do development. Therefore, I'm scared, and it's probably going to be bad, so I don't want it. I'm against it. So we want to make predictable outcomes. We want to start to create something for everybody, not just those who have the preference of a, you know, suburban lifestyle. So we want to make something for everybody at all stages of life as well, so that people can age in place. So a lot of communities we work in, people have to leave the city that they've lived in for maybe their whole lives once they get to the point where they no longer want to drive or can take care of their home or whatever, and so they have to leave. We want to balance the modes of transportation. So we heard about that in the community as well, and having some more transit options and enhancing economic viability. That's something that nearly every community can get behind. Everyone in the community can get behind. And then also having a code that is easier to use and administer. So that's the benefit to the developer and to the city staff, because they're the ones who have to administer it and the developers are the ones who have to use it. So those are the things that the character-based code is set up to do. And the way the character-based code is set up, instead of separating things one from the next, it thinks about things as a continuum from the most rural to the most urban, just like the way places used to develop, towns and cities and villages around the country. And so we have these character districts. And so in the most natural areas where you literally have preserved land, that's the character district one, nature. Moving in, you have character district two, which would be rural, and that's farmlands and, where there's sort of light human habitation as far as houses go, but there are people farming and doing other things. Then you get into the third zone, and that is where you have primarily detached single-family lots on houses on larger lots set back from the street. Moving into the fourth zone, you start to get some mixed use in there, so some commercial on the ground floor, maybe corner store, somebody living above, those sorts of things. And then as you get into the fifth zone, you start getting a lot more commercial, office, those sorts of things happening there, and also attached. So you'll have row houses and office buildings and things. So, but it's not about separation. This is a seamless sort of a flow from one area to the next. You sort of realize that after a moment that you've transitioned, but it's not like there's a stark contrast and we need to have buffers and fences and hedgerows and to keep these incompatible uses apart. So the uses are intermingled in an interesting way, but some areas are single use. So like in this third area, detached single family houses, there wouldn't be commercial in those areas as an example. So what they look like, sort of photographs. This is what nature looks like. Here's what agriculture looks like, farming. Getting into some of the character district three. And so when we were here the first time, we talked about this. Now we've started using pictures from here. So you can start to maybe recognize some of these places. You may even see your house or your business. Character district four, and then moving into the downtown, which would be your most intense urban area, which is character district five. And this is just based on, kind of our take on things. So we'll talk more about that with you guys as throughout this process of writing this code, because when we do this, each of these character districts is unique to the place that we're working in. So character district four isn't the same here as it is in the last city we were working in North Dakota, right? It's not the same as what we're doing in Colorado. And so what we'll do is we go through this process of understanding the essence of this place with what we call synoptic surveys. And so we've been out in the streets, on the sidewalks, measuring, the widths and the setbacks of the houses and how tall things are and all of the components of it that you understand as a participant in that, as you're walking down the street, what does this place feel like? What is the essence of this place? We've measured that in the most sort of loved areas of places where people say, well, we'd like to see more of that kind of happen. And so that makes it where we're able to customize each of these different character districts for you guys, not just for what we've done before. We've also done a zoning translation where we've taken your existing zoning zones, your existing ordinance zones, and we've said, okay, based on the setbacks and heights and those sorts of things, what do these most resemble based on these other character districts that we've been talking about? And so you start to realize there's a lot that are very similar with their dimensional, sort of setbacks and things. And so we can start to actually simplify the code. And so we're looking at opportunities to do that. And so we took, all of these different zones and we've simplified them into just the zones that we talked about in the character districts there a minute ago. So there's, five in this case. So as we go through and we write the code, we'll be creating, this is actually a page from one of the codes that we've written. If you've looked at your existing zoning ordinance or any other zoning ordinance across the country, they are pretty difficult to make your way to the end of. They're just sort of words on a page, not very interesting. It's not something you'd want to look at unless you absolutely had to, unless you were concerned about chickens in the backyard, right? So By the way, we're not opponents of chickens in the backyard. Chickens are cool in a lot of places. So this is an exciting page of zoning for you to look at comparatively. And this has all of the setbacks and constraints on here and, you know, has inspirational imagery for people to understand exactly what they're being asked to do. So it's much less vague. We focus on things like what we call frontage types. So how the building meets the street is really important. That's the way you, as a pedestrian, as a person experiencing the place, really understand it and sense it. And so we have these different frontage types, and this is what they look like. So we have common yards and porches and stoops and shop fronts, and each of those will be determine which zone they should be in. And then we have also building types. So we focus on what building types are appropriate in which zone. So for instance, in your downtown area, in your character district 5, it may not be appropriate to have a farmhouse there, right? It probably needs to be a mixed-use building and a little bit more urban in character. And so that's why it's important to talk about what types of buildings go where. It's not like in this one zone, this one building type is allowed. It's like these 5 building types are allowed in this zone. And so there's always a range of things too. So even when we talk about setbacks, we don't want it to just be, very monotonous and a monoculture. Because if you go out and you measure right now, you'll see that a lot of the houses, even though you kind of think that everything has the same setback, they don't. They actually have variation. And so the zoning will take that into consideration. And so we'll actually say, the setback, front setbacks will be between this many feet and that many feet instead of just one number. And so you start to allow for that natural thing to occur sort of organically, and it's really makes an interesting place. So here's some building types examples. So here's a house, and here is a mixed-use building. Those are just a couple of building types. We also will talk about sign standards. The sign standards will be geared towards the appropriate character district that they're in. And so in some zones, it's not appropriate to have signage. And it may be in a single-family residential neighborhood, unless it's like a real estate sign or something for somebody selling their house. But in other areas, it's very appropriate to have signage and have all different types of signage. And they'd be focused on the type of character that they're in. So we have civic space standards. So instead of just saying we want open space in development or in a neighborhood or in a certain part of the city, we say, well, we'd like to have specifically, a park or a plaza or a greenway. And so it's actually really a much more careful way to think about it. And each of these different types is appropriate in a different character district. We'll look at thoroughfare standards because what happens on the private lot isn't the only thing that's important. Actually, the character of the street, the public right-of-way, which would include sidewalks and planting strips and all of those things, that's important as well. And so we want to think about that and talk about that through this process so we can make sure that we sync up with the departments in the city that are in charge of those things as we go through. Now, for those of you who are concerned that I haven't mentioned uses yet, and uses can, maybe you're thinking, well, if we're just talking about character, can uses go anywhere? No, there will still be a use table. The use has just been taken from the most important thing to like the fifth most important thing, maybe. So it's just starting to change the way that we prioritize things here. So there will still be a robust table of uses, just like you have now. And so when you start to think about some of these abstract ideas that I've been talking about, sometimes it's helpful to start to see them in play. So this is a community we're working in. This is a vacant lot. There's a nice tree here on the corner, but right behind it, you can't see, there's a parking lot. They tore it down because they put a suburban-style bank in their historic downtown, right? And so what we wanted to do is show them as they look to redevelop in the future how they could transition and use the character-based approach to accomplish their goals of walkability and all of the things that they told us about. And so you can see here we created this, and this is the existing building. This was the parking lot area here. Just imagine that the trees are still there because they're great, but we had to take them out of the picture just so you could see what was going on behind it. And when you start to think about all these zoning-related things, so the setbacks in this case were, there was 0 here, but they allowed for the buildings to be pushed back a little further here so they could make a plaza on the corner, so the setbacks are important. We talked about the building type, so in this case they had small mixed use. Here's a live work and another small mixed use building. We talk about the number of stories, and so we were explaining to them, you wouldn't think you'd have to explain this, but in this community, height and how you calculated height was very important. And so we were saying, this is two stories. Somebody actually might be able to have a small apartment or something in the attic space up here, but that's still considered two stories. Here we're looking at the frontage types, so those are all shop fronts. And then we also talk about things like the percentage of glazing, which would be like how much window to wall you have on the front of a building. Because in the end, if you think about, imagine any of your, you know, your downtown businesses, if they had these sort of tiny, small windows, something out of a medieval fortress that you might shoot arrows through or something, it wouldn't have the same feeling of, you know, being a great, vibrant downtown district as when you have these great storefront windows. That said, you probably wouldn't want those storefront windows also on the second floor up here. So there's some, you know, some definition and description about how that's all sorted out so that you don't have things that are out of keeping or out of character. So here's what we've heard so far. We've been asking a lot of people questions because we're not from here, right? I flew in from Tennessee yesterday, right, from Nashville. I don't know this place like you guys do. So rather than, again, superimposing what we do in Nashville, what we do in North Dakota, what we do in Colorado, wherever, we want to make sure we understand the essence of this place. We've been asking you guys, you know, what makes this place unique? So, you know, we've heard about the cool concerts that happen here. We've seen the, you know, cool artwork in the intersection. And I don't know if you guys can see this, but this is the hot dog with the mac and cheese, which is really awesome if you haven't had one. I had one for lunch when I was here last time. Obviously, the university and, you know, having an amazing building like this as your city hall is really remarkable. And then even just little unexpected things like, you know, this is a very sort of a mundane doorway to, I don't even know what's behind it, but there's this cool art. Yeah. Nice. Yeah. So I love that. And as, you know, we look for this kind of stuff because that tells us something like arts are important here, you know, and it's really great. Here's some of the things we heard when we asked people, what do you like about Mount Pleasant the most? We heard the local parks, public art, sculpture, unique restaurants, locally owned businesses, concerts at Max and Emily's, river access, historical monuments, student community, beautiful parks again, walkable parks. Parks are getting high ranks. Downtown neighborhoods, the university, historic homes, walkability, friendly people, small town feel, football games, and abundance of parks again. So good job. Good job, Parks. Here are some of the things we heard that are perceived challenges. So we've heard that developers control development too much. We've heard there are too many nonconformities, that single-family houses are being converted into rooming dwellings, loss of historic single-family building stock, excessive parking requirements, Mission Street has this optional overlay. Current regulations push development outside the city. Developers can obtain special use permits for extra density and auto-oriented development along the corridors. Now, again, these are just things we've heard. These aren't things that we have identified as issues. So we're trying to understand as we go through the process more and more about, you know, why these things are issues and what things are great and, you know, all of that, because that becomes important as we go through the process. So we asked people, too, what should the character-based code do? So promote and encourage good development, provide incentives to get desired results, or just require the desired results. So there's a question of the, you know, do we have to incentivize things or can we just require it? Avoid unintended consequences, establish predictability, allow more housing downtown, improve signage standards, and improve streetscape and building facades. So those are great because those are all things that, you know, character-based codes can help with. And then as we go through this process this week and throughout, we've been trying to think about some of this geographically, right? So what are some of the areas to focus on and to focus the discussion on? Because a lot of the areas, it's pretty clear kind of people probably want things to stay about like it is around here or there or elsewhere. But we've heard that there's opportunities for improvement in downtown, and so we see things like, for instance, this is a really big parking lot where there used to be buildings, you know, so what impact is, like, obviously parking is important and we need parking, but what's the impact when we tear down buildings to put parking lots in the downtown area, and are there other ways that we can deal with that? There's some interesting alleyways that we saw, and, you know, you guys are already doing some unique things with some of the outdoor dining where you've taken over a couple of parking spaces there. And the thing that's great about it is, I mean, literally, and I keep mentioning North Dakota, we're working in West Fargo, North Dakota right now. I just got back from there last week, and they don't have any of, like, the historic downtown, the grid, the neighborhoods, the older neighborhoods, any of that. It's all very much suburban, and they want to create all of these things that you guys already have. So whereas we're working to enhance certain things that you already have, they're trying to start from scratch, which is really hard. So I'm so glad to be here, and I can walk around and see these things because it's really helpful and makes the job a lot easier. Now, that said, though, there are some inconsistencies in the character, even within a downtown area. So this is literally, I was standing in the intersection, and so I was like, oh, wow, take a picture. I turned around, took the other picture. And you wouldn't guess that they're the same street if you didn't know that. Most people, if they just saw the pictures, right? And so, you know, how does that happen? Is that a concern? And do we find ways to work on that in the future? Or do we encourage buildings to be, you know, wrapped and clad in, you know, modern materials and things and lose some of that historic character? So that's interesting. And you also see that in the neighborhoods as well. I've heard, you know, when a house gets torn down and a new house gets built, there's some character inconsistencies that people are concerned about. So we need to talk about what about the neighborhoods? You know, what do we need to do in the neighborhoods? Do we need to do anything? Leave them alone, keep them as they are? Or, you know, some places we go, they say, you know, we'd really like to transform what's happening here. So this neighborhood is, you know, really kind of old, and not old historic, but just old. And so we might like to see some redevelopment happen in that neighborhood. And I mean, like, the people who live in that neighborhood are saying that, not people who live in the next neighborhood over. And so we like to talk about, you know, what you guys would like to see in the neighborhoods. Here's an image of the redevelopment kind of stuff that we've heard about. So this is one example where, you know, we heard that when a new house, you know, new building came in, it really changed the character of, you know, the existing neighborhood. And so we want to learn, you know, about what that means to people and if there are good examples as well. We obviously have heard about student housing, right? Obviously, that's one of the first things we hear about. And so which ones are the ones that people are happy about? Which ones are the ones that were not an improvement to the neighborhood? Those kinds of things will be important, not just to pick on them, but to understand why. That's really all I care about, is which things about them were not successful in the community's mind, and which things were, because those are the kinds of things, assuming that there will still be students here, right? That's a pretty safe assumption. Then we're going to need to sort out how to house students in a way that everybody's excited about. And, you know, is this equivalent, you know, to this or this? And, you know, what's the, you know, this is very interesting, you know, kind of talk, we're talking about the glazing percentages before, and this is an example of, you know, they may have could used another window right there or something, you know, that might have helped that facade. So the thing to note, though, is that the character-based approach does not focus on architecture. It doesn't focus on architecture very much, a little bit. And it can to a greater or lesser degree, depending on what the community's appetite is for dealing with architecture. So for those who are thinking I'm saying this is a code and we're going to regulate everyone's architecture, I'm not saying that. So we'll talk about how much architecture you guys want regulated, but just to clarify that. So because the student housing thing is such a hot topic and comes up so many times, we said, let's go learn more about this. Let's go figure out, you know, what people in other communities are doing and see, you know, kind of what solutions that people have come up with. Now, first and foremost, in other communities, they, and not that you guys aren't, because you are, recognize that the students are a valuable part of the community, right? That the university is vital to the community. So this is just an exercise in sort of sorting out the inherent conflicts that occur in every college town, right? This isn't for you guys only. So we went and looked at places all across the country and even found some studies where people looked at this around the world, in England and some other places. So One of the things that people are doing is restricting the definition of family. They're also enforcing codes and standards. Enforcement seems to be maybe like a number one topic in most of these communities. It's really just about enforcement. They are issuing residential parking permits, inspecting rentals and licensing landlords so that you actually have to be permitted to be a landlord. It's an honor. And implementing rooming house programs, targeting disorderly houses, encouraging owner occupancy and responsible management, limiting occupancy based on parking availability, and establishing an overlay or some other conservation district to discourage demolition of historic properties. Now, all of the things that are in blue, which is everything except for three things, and there's one in orange, and I'll explain that, they're all things you're doing already, right? So you guys are really on top of this. And I said that enforcement is maybe the most important thing. Enforcement is happening here in a way that it hasn't been happening in the past, is from what I've heard. So that is all getting sorted out, but it takes a minute for that to happen, right? It takes a minute for everybody to realize what's going on. Now, the one in orange is one that is something that you guys have been doing, and maybe you've sort of changed the direction because of, you know, we talked about unintended consequences before, and so like, okay, well, we had an idea about a way to accomplish this goal, but that didn't work, so let's adjust that. So you guys have done that, have tried that. So I guess the long and the short of it is, I show you this to say that there is no silver bullet. Through this process, anybody who wants to solve all of the concerns you have about this, it's just not going to happen. So if we can assume that there will continue to be students here, and they're still a valuable part of the community, and probably half or more of you were them a few years ago, right? Not so long ago. Sometimes you forget when they have a party next year that I was that kid, you know, once upon a time. Maybe let's not have that be the primary focus of our discussion, right? And so we'll focus on the other things that are related to zoning. Not that you can't talk about this, but recognize that zoning can only have a limited impact on this. So we have so many communities we work in, there's like a hot topic always, and it tends to dominate the conversation. So you have to work hard to not let it. So those are important things. Now, we've also heard that the corridors aren't what you hope they might be, right? They're auto-oriented, suburban corridors, you know, like, what are you going to do? There's a lot you can do. A lot of communities are actually transforming their auto-oriented corridors in unbelievable ways to make them, you know, as great as, you know, some of the other parts of town that are the most loved and really has a positive economic impact on the community and also has a positive quality of life and safety impact. I think this is actually your one of your roads here, and this person is the bravest man in town. Right? Like, he's not even looking, right? He's probably texting. That's probably why he's not looking. But so we're going to talk about that and maybe what we can do to improve that. And then also, too, you know, like, it's easy to talk about the sexy stuff, but there's stuff that has to go on here, too, like in industry, and to make this a real community, a complete community. And so how do we deal with that as well? We're probably not, you know, going to make the industrial zones walkable, mixed use, compact and diverse, right? So they're what we call a special district, right? They have their own sort of set of standards, and we say they are necessary, they are what they are, but we're not trying to have them sort of follow the same rules as all these other places that we're really trying to work on and make great. So we'll talk about that as well, because that's important to a lot of people in the community. So timeline, we are here. We've already gone through steps here. We had a kickoff several weeks ago, maybe a couple of months ago now, lost track. So we're here, we're sort of in the halfway point, but we've not actually begun working too much on writing the code. That's really why we're here. We're going to be working on writing the code. This isn't just a touchy-feely, dreamy exercise. Like, we're literally going to be working hard, and we'll be talking to you to get input. So we'll go through this process, and hopefully it looks like we'll be done at the end in September 2017. It says adoption down here. So that's the adoption process. It depends on all of you, though. It depends on a few things. One, how much you participate in the process and actually feel like it is your plan and it's your zoning, right? Not just something that the consultants brought to you. So if this is the last time you participate until it comes up for a vote, that's probably not the best approach, so you need to stay involved. And then the other is, it depends on how much you decide you want to be the pilot and if you want to learn how to fly an airplane, right? And so if you everybody wants to learn to fly the airplane, it takes a lot longer as well. So we'll go through with you guys. So what's next immediately in about 5 minutes is the table exercise, and I'll tell you about that. And then while we're here, we are going to have an open studio. So once we break down this room, we're actually going to set up our office back there in the back corner, and we'll be here for the next several days until Monday when the final presentation is. And so we're going to be working here on site. So if you can't come to one of these roundtable meetings, we have them on Saturday starting at 9 to 3:30. The different topics are downtown, corridors, university liaison group, economic development, industrial districts. Now, you can come to any of those or all of those. Everything we do here is open. There's no invitation only. Everything we do here is open. So come and participate. If you're particularly passionate about downtown, just come to that one. If you want to talk about downtown and industrial, you're also perfectly welcome to come to those. But we'll also be here working in the room in our office, and you can come in. If you missed a meeting or something, come in on Sunday. You want to drop in, you know, the lights are on. You're welcome. So it's just we know that our scheduling doesn't work for everybody. So that's important as well. And then we'll have, you know, what we call a work in progress presentation. It's sort of the closing presentation of this event, of the Planapalooza. And that'll happen at 7 o'clock on Monday night. And there we'll actually be showing you some of the results. We'll actually have some of the artist renderings of the different character districts and those kind of things. Those will be created this week while we're here. And so that'll be really fun as well. So if you want to be involved, there's the Facebook page, and then on the city webpage, there are opportunities to learn about things there as well. So check in on those and comment and post things and post pictures. If you took pictures tonight, post them on the Facebook page. Tell everybody how much fun it was. You're going to have fun in a minute, I promise, once I shut up. And so what we're going to do now is the table exercise. So when you came in, you got a name tag, and the name tag had a number on it, and you then all sat down with your friends. And that's okay. That's what people do. And during the presentation part, that's fine. It's really great, though, and the reason we put the numbers is they correspond to the numbers on the tables. And that helps everybody split up from their friends, because then you actually have a diversity of ideas. And so the exercise will be better for it. If you can't bear it, that's okay. We don't want to make it unpleasant for you. I'm not a particularly social person, so sitting with a bunch of strangers makes me feel very anxious. So that's okay. There are also are comment cards and things somewhere that we have.
Surveys.
So you can fill out the surveys. If you don't like to talk to people, you can sit quietly at your table and listen and then fill out your survey later. Or you can do both. So what's going to happen is you guys are going to draw on these maps, and you're going to put dots on the maps. And the table with the most dots wins a prize, the most marks on the map, right? So it's a contest. You want to, you know, outdo the next table. Shh, don't tell the prize. The prize is you can take all the extra donuts home, right? So there are instructions on the table, but in a nutshell, here's what you're going to do. You're going to have green dots, red dots, and blue dots, and the green dots are for areas that you really love, so you're going to put a dot there. The cool thing is that you can see through the dots when you put them on, so we can still see where you put the dot. The red dots are the areas that need improvement. The blue dots are areas for opportunities, like, oh, it'd be really cool if we did something with this area, we did something over there. So that's what the dots are for. You're going to take the markers, and you're going to draw things that are, you know, like you say, oh, you know what, this road over here, they cut that off 40 years ago, we should really connect that road back up. So you're going to draw that, and you're going to say, you know, connect. And you're going to circle where you live, though, or where you work, or whatever, you know, sort of whatever your affiliation with. Find yourself on the map so that everybody knows also where you're from and introduce yourself. And then if there are things that you can't draw and that aren't just dot-worthy, if they're just an idea or something, you say, like, oh, you know what we need? You know, we really need to improve our environmental sustainability or something like that, right? You're going to write that just on the side of the map, and so just make notes, right? And so at the end of the workshop exercise, what we're going to do is going to each table is going to present their work. They're going to pick your like top three, have something like top three ideas, and you're going to come up and stand up in the front, and somebody's going to hold the map, and somebody on the team's going to present it. And then we're going to be documenting all of the ideas as we go. And then after each group presents, because that's really hard, because most people don't like to stand up and their voice cracks and things, right? And so then you're all going to clap for them too, right? So we're going to make sure everybody feels special. So before we do that, can we have a little bit of Q&A? Anything that we've talked about that is confusing, concerning, exciting, anything we can talk about? Oh, come on. You guys had all kinds of questions last time. New people. Really? Not about the exercise, about this, the presentation, right? Zoning, we're talking about changing the zoning in your city. No worries, no concerns? Yeah. Oh, thanks. Yeah, I like that. Those comments are good too. So, okay, good. So do we all understand zoning? Yes. Yes. So write about the kind of things that are important to you that you want to enhance and increase and all of those kind of things. Yes. Who is an expert on the comp plan here? Yes, Jacob, thank you. The planner. Yes, to a degree, he said. Right. This is unbelievable. Okay, so I think you guys just can't wait to draw and write. So, all right, so I'm going to let you guys, Becky keeps holding her hand up. Am I forgetting? I'm always forgetting something. What is it, Becky?
Table 10 is not in this room. We have an extra table. So anyone who got a table 10 on their name tag, go through that doorway down there.
Yeah, that's a great thing to have happen. So, by the way, don't forget, you've got to talk to each other through this process, though, right? It makes it a lot easier. So what we're going to do is the team's going to float around, and I'll come around, and Becky and my dad, and Bill is my dad, by the way. So on your mark, get set, go. Up here, group number one, so you have your presenter and your map holder, and we'll come up, and hello, testing, is this thing on? All right, so everybody in the back, we're going to start the presentations now for the groups, and if group number two could come up and get on deck, so that way we can actually, and each group goes, and the next group after them stands up, it'll help us go faster, so I love it that nobody wants to stop talking. That's awesome. It's actually the one time this is a good problem to have, so. Okay. You guys ready? They're on deck, so you guys are up first. You can just come up here. Yeah, at the mic, so everybody can hear you. You got it. Don't be shy. Don't be shy. And just so you know, everybody, we know that sometimes people have more stuff on their maps than others, and it's okay.
Yeah, two holders. I'm kind of art-rageous, if you will. So I had the idea of having a place where there's like a botanical garden and a labyrinth with some geodesic dome kind of thing you could be under with lights on some of the panels, or maybe a pyramid that's built specifically with nice things that are correct proportions for good energy and meditation, and maybe fun music in there going on, meditative music, and other things can happen. So what else? Let's flick this upside down, because the writing is that way. Hello. What's something can go on here? Oh, a big improvement. I'm a crossing guard. There's the lanes need to be like 25 miles with flashing things. It's a school zone because people are running a red light a lot. And then person had an idea of where the Native American boarding school area is to, now we're upside down again. What does that say? Put the county office in this part with the jail and stuff, and then green space back here with other kinds of activities that are more natural, like the Native American. Don't mess with the graveyard land. And be happy and improve the, with their input, too. So, is that three things?
That's three. Great, thank you.
Okay.
Okay, our ideas were a collaborative effort or a local family, and we had a group of college students. So our ideas are a mix of things, but mostly we all agreed, I mean, we all had the same concern about traffic flow along Mission and the safety about students being able to get around because there's a lot of housing across the community and students traveling across the community to get to campus. So, and that kind of stretched from all the way over by Isabella all the way to the other side of Mount Pleasant. So just kind of looking for safety with students being able to bike and walk, but mainly along the concentrated areas along Mission. We all identified that we really enjoyed the green spaces and how much that the community uses them, looking at ways to even improve them because a lot of people use like the Chippewa River, but we've had some more recent concerns with the ability to use it because of E. coli levels and things like that, so maybe looking at ways to improve the clean, the cleanliness of the river just so that we can keep that as an ongoing use and business and community asset. And then we wanted to look at what kind of things that we haven't reached out for that maybe just looking at some a little bit more diverse types of business opportunities in the downtown area. We really enjoy all of the opportunities and businesses that we have, but just trying to see what ways we might be able to see what else we can just really come down in downtown and just have a really great diverse things to look through and shop with. And then even maybe having a large, I know we like our small businesses, but also even maybe a big bookstore, because you do have to travel at least 45 minutes to, or about a good half hour to get to a big bookstore. So. Okay.
Table number three, and then if table number four can get up here and be ready to go, then we'll try to get you guys home on time tonight.
Well, I need to look at it this way because that's north, south, east, and west. A couple of things. Quality of life issues, retirement living is one, student concentrated housing here, having a comprehensive environment, a quality of life for both of those. I know down here in this area, there's a lot of student housing, a lot of apartments. haphazard, if you will. Haphazard is another way to describe what's happening on the west side here with this industrial up on North Pickard up there. There's a history, there is, and if we're going to improve areas to make it more useful, to encourage investment in those areas, what we've been talking about here can do that. There was some downtown, again, we talked to about moving the county. The county's, you know, the land where the county buildings are right now, county offices, jail, courts, moving them out to the Mount Pleasant Center and freeing that up for some townhouses down there, row houses, brownstone walk-ups, somewhere where we can get more people living downtown. And students love it. I love it. It's an important area to sustain because it's part of what makes Mount Pleasant as meaningful as it is. That and the university experience too. Now there's some again those safety issues on Mission. And when you look at this, you've got a whole bunch of housing here, a whole bunch of housing here, and everybody's coming and going to the university. And I know we saw that picture up there, the guy crossing the street. We see it every day. And you know, you wonder how they make it. Well, they make it because they're young and fast. I wouldn't. I would need a cross light. And anyway, so that was some of the things we looked at. And we all liked, of course, all the green space in the parks, whether they're concentrated downtown by the river or the soccer parks on either side of the town. Those are important again for families too, and have them close nearby. So a bookstore downtown seems to be getting a lot of love. We'll see what we can do.
We love our parks.
There you go. Is it okay? All right.
I promise these were not my issues, my table's issues. So the first one is that we wanted to revitalize downtown. We felt like there's a lot of opportunity for new buildings, some brownstones along Broadway, making some of the older, sadder-looking buildings look older and pretty. The second one is increased walkability. Obviously, that's an issue everywhere. There's a lot of corridors that need a lot of improvement, sidewalk finishing. And then the third one is we immediately started identifying lots that were empty that could have redevelopment on them for infield development. So making sure that those empty, underutilized spaces are full and happy. 1, 2, 3. Thanks.
And I brought my model. Vanna's going to show you where we are. Three of the best ideas. We had one of our gentlemen that suggested we have traffic which is coming from east or west, and if all they want to do is get from one side of the state to the other, they are forced to come through our Pickard Street, Mission, and out Remus. And it would be nice not to take that traffic. It would be nice to get that bypassed us. They would have the opportunity to come in if they want to come to our stores or our restaurants, but give them an easy way out and around and alleviate some of the traffic. We talked about the Mission Street and Broomfield Road, the issues of traffic on those, but not just that it's an issue, how do we fix it? So we were looking at what's wrong with Broomfield Road as we're coming out this way. It's only a 4-lane. There is no turn lane there. So you have to be careful of the person in front of you because you never know when they're going to stop immediately and try and make a left, which they can't get across. So I don't know that the answer is to put a fifth lane there, but maybe we should be looking at a turn lane, one lane going each way, and take that extra room for the pedestrians and the bikers. You've already got the wider right-of-ways, you've already got that space set aside. Why not utilize that to make everything a little bit more friendly? Taking the same concept up and down on Mission, you may even have room for, it's kind of Frogger out there. You've got to run to that center island, and then you run to the next. But if you're only having to cross three lanes instead of five lanes, or there's a center green space that you can get to, and you can take a breath before you try to make the next, then the last idea that we thought would help with the Frogger situation is bridges across for pedestrians and bikers. But you can't use the bridges that you have to take the stairway up, walk across, take the stairway down. No one is going to carry their bike up. And if they're having to walk the stairs, they're not going to use it. If it's a ramp situation, in a gradual ramp, takes up a lot of space, it's hard to put in, but we think two or three of them down in this area to get the students from one side to the other safely would be a great improvement. So those are our three.
Thank you. Okay, so our three issues. The one thing, like everyone else has been saying, Mission, especially that section right here between Bellows and Broomfield, where there is a lot of students living in this area, coming across, going to CMU. I've been a student in that area, and it's very dangerous and hard to walk, you know, or travel at all from that area onto campus. That's a high traffic area. We also mentioned downtown and the fact that we love it. We would like to see some improvements, more historical preservation. One of our table members mentioned like adding things to beautify or bring more like cool things like amphitheaters there. And then we also said like more small businesses, bookstores. I would also love a bookstore downtown. And then our third issue was more bike paths and sidewalks in general in Mount Pleasant, but not, we also had a concern that it's not really an issue in all of the neighborhoods in Mount Pleasant. Some neighborhoods are smaller and would prefer to have that small, you know, we don't need a sidewalk on every street. We like that it's quiet and you can play in the street here and not feel like there's just buzzing, you know, everywhere. So those were our three issues that we kind of talked
about. All right, we had four major issues, and they generally overlapped with what tables 1 through 6 had said previously. First is Mission Street and the connectivity for both pedestrians and bicyclists trying to cross, like the crosswalk of doom over by between Wendy's and near Big Boy to get from east to west. There's a lot of college students living either side, as well as people who live in neighborhoods east of there trying to get to campus in a safe manner. As well as it's well north and south of there before you get to another traffic light for crossing. If someone's in a wheelchair, they're not going to make it across two lanes northbound, two lanes southbound with a turn lane in between. It's an awfully wide space to cover and the span that you have to cross. We also had a table had consensus on the downtown district, as well as, you know, I just want to see more vibrancy downtown, but also a bit more utilized park space downtown. We've got that nice little park by Main and Broadway, but we felt that if the park was a little bit larger, whether it was taking away some of the parking in the north and west or one way or another, it would actually get used more, because you'd have more room to throw a frisbee, you'd have more spaces to hang out there than just the park that's about from, you know, here to, you know, halfway across the room. That's not, it'd be better utilized if you actually had more space there. Looked at rentals for people of a wide variety of income levels. Most of the rentals in this town have to, you're really dealing with the student market. And so young professionals and people who might be living in town for 3 to 5 years, maybe they don't want to buy a house. They might want to go buy a condo or something else. Having more options for people looking to relocate to Mount Pleasant or stay here long term would also be good. And so that's it. Time for table 8.
So 40-mile-an-hour corridors through town. On Isabella Road, we understand it. On Mission, we don't. We add our voices to all the others. Build a darn bridge at Appian Way. Another one of our ideas was to expand the constellation of city parks by connecting Island Park to Mission Creek Park, perhaps along the railroad or something there. And several of us lived in the Wana neighborhood area, which is Grand Central for Porch Fest next June. And so we like the corridors there, Fancher, Kinney, Washington, and there is room for some development over near the tracks. There are some abandoned warehouses, the old CMU building that's an empty lot downtown. Those are the ideas we had.
Our three ideas started with the downtown, just like many of you guys. Our group really liked the downtown. We think it's a great place to hang out, but we feel that there's a need and space for more commercial and residential development, and also a place where we can make it more accessible for entertainment uses. We kind of, at the last second, came up with the idea of maybe moving the jail, and if we could move the jail, it would open up a space for development there. And then also we talked about how it would be nice to have like maybe a plaza or a town square area where people could walk around, you could have entertainment there, and on the outside you could have restaurants, cafes, a bookstore, anything really. Our second big idea was to preserve single-family housing, especially in traditional residential areas, obviously between maybe High Street and the downtown area. I kind of brought up a little bit of how on the west side of town we have a lot of like condos being built up and how it kind of just doesn't fit necessarily the character of the rest of the town. But we also address the need that we have a lot of affordable housing that goes up in those areas, and those are important to avoid maybe what we have on Bradley over by the trailer park. And then Riverwalk development. We really like to highlight the river, make it just more accessible, make it more visible to our visitors in the downtown, and balance that need for bringing people there with environmental concerns. And that's it.
Okay, I think we're the last group. I mean, really, we don't have anything too new to say from what the other groups have said. Kind of one specific feedback we had was, we love downtown, absolutely love it. Everyone else has said that. We feel like there needs to be a stop sign at Washington and Michigan, where that dance studio is. We feel like there has been some confusion about where that, yeah. So that was kind of one of our more specific ideas. We, like I said, we love downtown, but we feel like the business hours are not accessible for working families. I tend to be down, I take classes on Saturday morning downtown. I get out at 11, and the businesses are almost never open. Although there's a lot of really great boutiques downtown, but we don't feel like they're open. So we would love some expansion on that. In addition to that, the Parcel B lot we feel like has a lot of potential. We would love to see something really useful go in that lot. And then the last thing I just want to add, everyone else has talked about the parks. My husband and I live on the west side of town, and we see how great the parks are and how families are utilizing the parks. We feel like east of Mission, there's not a lot of green over there. So we would love to see some more parks go in over there. So yeah, those are our three ideas.
Okay, so for those of you who are wondering, what a lot of what was said has to do with zoning, it does, it's related. So for us, the team, we're listening to all of these comments, and some of these things are accomplished through zoning, and some of them aren't. But the things that you want to accomplish tell us things about your values, things that are important to you, issues and concerns. And so then the zoning can be worked as we're looking at the mapping and things to make sure that we can accomplish some of those from a land use perspective and character perspective as well. So somebody's always comes up at the end and says, you know, that was all interesting, but what does that have to do with zoning? So it's relevant. So it is maybe 2 minutes until nine. So pretty good timing there. I'm still concerned that you guys didn't ask any questions after the presentation. That's really like, that never happens. I mean, I know I say a lot of stuff, and so I like to think I'm very thorough. Just so you know, this is recorded tonight, right? So when it comes time for the zoning to be approved many, many months from now, we'll have this on tape where we'll show you all. It's just like, hey, I know you're here to complain and be concerned tonight, but remember you said you had no questions or concerns on that first night, right? So we'll have that for you. We'll replay that. All kidding aside, though, surely some of this discussion has spurred questions or hopes and dreams and aspirations, and it doesn't all have to be concerning. Yes, I knew it. Yes. How varying setbacks work? Sure. So let's see. So if you go to any of the, let's say, pick your favorite street, right? We use a measuring wheel, but you can just step it off. Step off from the back of the sidewalk to the front of the house for several houses down the street. And what you'll find is that in most neighborhoods, there's some consistency, but it's not exactly the same. So you might find that on, you know, any given street, it's between 10 and 15 feet. So there's sort of a 5-foot variation. But if you just said the front setback in this neighborhood is 12, all of a sudden all the houses are lined up at 12, and it becomes much less interesting than if there's some variation. Now, granted, you know, especially in a historic neighborhood, I remember there's this one example that I always look at in Annapolis, Maryland. And it's this very consistent historic neighborhood within a small variation. And there's this one house that's set back like 40 feet. It's got this grand front yard, and everybody else pretty much has a stoop. And so it completely throws off, you know, the sort of the range of setbacks. And so that's an outlier. And so you say, okay, you know, interesting nowadays. And probably if they had asked for approval at that time, people would have said, well, that doesn't fit in at all, you know. And so so anyway, so that's kind of how it works. Not a wide range of variation, but. Go for it. So, and that's a great question. So, the question is, if you have a range, the developers tend to want to go to the minimum, so then you end up with a de facto straight line across, like I was saying, we're trying to keep from happening. Now, I'm really glad you pointed that out and asked that question, because in many communities, the person who would be doing the redevelopment would just be a homeowner. And the homeowner might say, I'd like to have more front yard, rather than cramming as much development on the property as possible. But here, when you have redevelopment, it tends to be somebody trying to put student housing in or something like that that is, you know, a developer, per se. And so that's something we're going to need to take into consideration. So we have to kind of think through the issue. But it doesn't always happen. I mean, what you'll find is that between 10 and 15 feet isn't all that much in a lot of cases, depending on the lot, depending on the neighborhood, depending on where you are in this. Obviously, in a very small lot street, it makes a huge difference, you know. So we'll have to sort that out. It's hard because you don't want to be necessarily artificially, you know, requiring diversity, and, you know, so you have to be set back 2 feet from the last guy, but then the next guy has to be 3 feet from him, and, you know, so these kind of things. So, but the point is well taken. You know, how do we accommodate for sort of market forces and people trying to maximize the value of their property? Right. Yeah, thanks for pointing that out. I mean, that's a specific thing to this place for us to remember to take into consideration. So that's a great point. Thank you. Yes. Sure. No, that's great. And so from our perspective, you know, tearing it down, moving things or whatever, those are sort of long range, you know, ideas and goals. But what happens there when they move, not where do they go, but what happens on the site where they move from becomes important to the zoning discussion for sure. So thanks.
It's not that long term.
Great. Yes. That's a really interesting idea, having mixed use and student housing and stuff on Mission. And you know, you think about it, if people are already crossing, and typically what we see, and I don't know if that's the case here, but people tend to cross in certain locations. It's not just happening all up and down, right? So maybe you take those locations, and those are the locations for some node, you know, an area of, you know, a change. You know, it changes to this new character you just described. And other areas maybe can stay more in the sort of conventional auto-oriented, but a better version, you know. And in some communities we go to, though, they say, you know what, like, the days of the auto strip highway are done for us. That was great, and it's nice and all that. But we're a desirable enough community that we want a wholesale transformation. And we want this entire area to be, you know, really great character instead of just anywhere USA strip highway. So that's a different discussion, but one we need to have as we're figuring out what do we do with Mission. It's kind of a long road, and so it's like if we focus on the, seems like focusing on nodes of activity or intensity seems to be pretty straightforward, as you just described. Hearing that over and over and over from the community, there's an issue on Mission, we need to sort that out. But then what do we do with the rest of it? It's kind of the question mark. So we'll talk about that as we go through this process together. Anybody else? Only the ones that kicked your fence in, not all of them.
Look at
Well, and for, I like how great is that he identified himself as the as the devil, as a, you know. So I'm proud. Thank you for that, for being so bold. So I think that just the outsider's take on it is this. It sounds like you guys are getting a handle on the enforcement side of things, which is going to, you know, over time as it goes and goes, it makes a huge difference. Because last time I was here, everybody, you know, I heard students freaking out, like, they're, you know, cracking down on us, you know. And that's people taking notice, right? And then first you yell about it, you take notice, and then you start changing your behavior, right? So those kind of things happen. And so it sounds like you guys are doing that. I think the other thing that I've been hearing about from the community is it's not just a behavioral thing, it's a character thing. All the things we talked about tonight. Because a lot of the buildings that are going in, the new buildings that are, forget if they're, who cares who's living inside just for a minute, right? Let's call them just new buildings in the existing neighborhoods. They aren't in keeping, in many, many cases, with the character of the neighborhood. They stand out as new and different. And they're shiny, and in many cases, they tore down something that, you know, nobody was, you know, sort of cherishing as a, you know, part of the neighborhood that they just can't bear to part with. They're not trying to list them on the historic register. It was like, you know, something that was like, oh, okay, good, they tore that down. And then they're like, oh, no, what came in now is maybe new, but maybe not better, right? And so I think that going through this process, one of the things we can do is address the other side of the coin, not the behavior side, but the character side, and getting the students and whomever chooses to live in buildings that are in keeping with the character of the neighborhood. And that's going to sort of maybe solve the last problem, I hope. And so as we go through this process, we'll start to learn about what parts of and aspects of the character are precious, that you cherish, that you want to, you know, continue on. And then we'll also figure out where the newer buildings are falling short in that regard. Without making them, you know, gold-plated, without making them have to, you know, use, you know, platinum bricks for their instead of vinyl siding and, you know, all of these kinds of things. We need to figure out a way that these guys can still make money, but you guys can get the character that you want. And then the behavior will get sorted out, however it gets sorted out, not through zoning. So, yes. A practical solution. I love those. Thank you for that. I love also people dreaming big. Yes. What's your name? Ramon. This is Ramon. And to your point, Ramon, too, you know, as you said, no family is going to buy a house and want to move in there. And so those who find themselves there, I think, are finding themselves there because it's the creep.
As long
And by the way, we're after 9 o'clock now, so anybody who does need to go, don't feel like you're being rude, but I'll literally stand here as long as you guys want to keep talking. So just want to throw that out there. Right. Glow in the dark. Yeah. We got one over here. Another vote for Bridges. Yeah, great. No, thank you. That's valuable insight. Yes. We have these dots. We have extra dots you can use. Just. Thank you. All right, I'm noticing people are starting to trickle out, which is, again, okay. So any other last, final question? Yes. Oh, yeah, don't forget, we've got a dozen for each of you, right? And some cider, and okay, seeing no other hands, I just have to say thank you guys for showing up. We were nervous. This is great. The turnout was huge, and you guys have been really engaged, and please continue to be so. And also make sure you come tomorrow to the roundtable meetings, and especially to the closing presentation on Monday at 7, and stay involved throughout. Thank you. Oh, surveys. Fill out your surveys. Put them in the back.
You can leave completed surveys at the table. We'll pick them up, or you can take incomplete ones home and bring them back. We've got copies on the table and copies at the front table.
Now you can go. Thank you.